Good day. Today we are going to discuss the delays in courts and time and case management. We have with us Raju Ramachandran, senior advocate in the Supreme Court. He's done a lot of work and thinking on this. Raju, what do you think are the major problems in terms of time management, particularly, let's start with the Supreme Court or the High Courts?
Yes, and the superior courts, of which you and I have more experience, what you notice is that there is no control over the time which a case is going to be argued, because we don't have a system of time limits on oral arguments. And we have all grown up in this tradition of oral advocacy being an art, and how the longer you are able to argue, the feeling that you are going to persuade the judge to pass an order in your favor, to decide the case in your favor. I think that needs to end. A 21st century court can't afford this anymore. If the US Supreme Court can set time limits for the most important constitutional cases, I think we have reached the stage when, in final hearings at least, we must have time limits backed by written briefs.
Yeah, I mean, the major problem, I mean, if we can start with the Supreme Court or even the High Court, I have found that, you know, everything is completely ad hoc. There is no time limit to a case, even in constitutional matters. Recently, we had a case where the constitutional matter, constitution bench, judgment has been delivered. But the opening side argued for 5 days. And when our turn came, the learned judges of the court said, please limit yourself to 2 hours. So there is complete ad hocism. So I think what you're saying is, for a case, first of all, there should be time limits.
That's right.
But if you have time management like this, then firstly, there have to be proper procedures for written briefs. I was in Brazil recently arguing a case for on the abortion, and they have strict time limits, 20 minutes each, but they are all backed by written briefs. So 1 month before, 40 to 50 page memoirs have to be put in. So therefore, your point that it has to be backed by written briefs has to be emphasized.
That's right.
And you can't have more than 50 pages. And then within 2 weeks thereafter, you have an abstract, and then the actual presentation, which is going to be 20 minutes. I don't think we will be able to adjust to 20 minutes, but even 1 hour each, or right, 2 hours each, there should be strict limits which can actually be done. But also in terms of time management, Raju, what about dates? When I started practice in Bombay, there was a judge who used to, in fact, put up all the matters on the first day and list the matters which are for final hearing, and then give dates, week and the day. And that matter would come up on that week. During that week, it will be adjusted within 1 or 2 days. So everybody knew when the matter would be come up. What about that? So timing has to be done also on that.
No, that's possible if we didn't have ad hocism in the constitution of benches. Now, it can be done in the Supreme Court also if there's a will. If a bench has a fixed duration, let us say from the January term to the May term, dealing with a particular subject,
yes,
then at the beginning of the term, all the cases which are likely to be listed in that term can be listed on a particular day just for orders, and the judges, or in consultation with the lawyers for orders or directions.
In consultation with lawyers, clients, everybody.
And clients are important stakeholders, remember, in a place like the Supreme Court, especially when people are coming from all over the country, they can't be waiting here for days and weeks and go back without the case reaching. So this time management can be done at that stage, that cases number 1 to 15 will be done in the week of so-and-so to so-and-so. And then, except for a day here or there, when a case may not reach, in that week, all those cases will be done.
Yes.
It's possible to do so, but then you need one bench. There can't be midweek changes of benches. There can't be special benches at 2 o'clock.
Yeah, in fact, because of ad hocism, you have special benches being constituted.
That's right.
There has to be a stability in the rostering of the benches in terms of what matters will be taken up by which benches.
That's right.
Labor matters, tax matters, arbitration, etc., etc. And you can't have everybody taking up. So there needs to be division of this thing, of work, which will allow that. The other problem that you were talking to me earlier is that suddenly, if the judge is retiring or is being posted to another court, suddenly there's a breakup of the courts. I saw that in the High Court the other day. What about that issue?
That's a common feature in all High Courts, where when a judge is retiring, there's a full court reference. In many High Courts, especially in North India, there's also a practice of court suspending work if a lawyer passes away.
This has to stop.
Now, this has to stop completely. All these references have to be held after court hours.
Or before court hours.
Or before court hours. And I also include full court references when, say, eminent judges die, eminent lawyers die. You fix the date, but you can't eat up valuable court time.
Public time. Which is
public time for which the taxpayer is paying by holding a reference. Then the court adjourns for some time. Then the court will sit at 11:30 instead of 10:30. 1 hour is lost. Then again, swearing in of judges.
Yes.
Swearing in of judges. Suddenly, warrants are issued. And then there'll be four judges sworn in. So 10:30, four oaths. Then tea after that. So that day's calendar goes for a six, because only one day in advance you know that there's going to be a swearing in. And so the court has lost 1 hour or 1 1/4 hours.
That can be adjusted if you do it after court hours.
After or before?
Before.
Before.
Yes.
Why can't the swearing in happen at 10 a.m.?
Yes. Now, the other thing is that a lot of time is being wasted of trying to get matters on board and mentioning.
Yes.
Like, of course, in the Supreme Court, it is only one bench or two benches. Why should that happen? Why can it not be done by the registrar? Why can't directions be issued? And why can't the registrar be involved with the judge concerned to map out the agenda for the week or for the next day?
I'm not too sure whether the registrar solution would work for urgent mentionings, because there are cases where judicial mind needs to be applied for listing also. Sometimes you may not be able to convince a registrar of the urgency of a matter, and you might need to appeal to the judge about its urgency. I don't think that's such a major factor before a particular bench, because that takes up, say, 5 minutes or 7 minutes in the morning. I don't think that's really the major problem, except, of course, in the Supreme Court, the mentioning before the Chief Justice's court,
that
which goes on for
half an hour sometimes.
Half an hour sometimes.
Now it's only 15 minutes.
Yes. But there also the mentioning time can be limited to 10 or 15 minutes. And I think now the Chief Justice is doing it.
It's only 15 minutes.
And also, if this mentioning gets dispersed subject-wise,
yes,
you should be able to persuade a particular judge who's dealing with that particular subject for that semester that case needs to be taken up early. So if that mentioning becomes diffuse, then you don't lose
short.
That's right.
But actually, one of the predicating factors is going to be that there has to be division of benches issue-wise, subject-wise.
Right.
So final hearing has to be on that basis.
That's right.
That's a precondition for actually having stability of courts who can then have a semester time used and then plan out those cases.
And now, though there's a disclosed roster, the change of benches midstream disrupts the schedule.
Yes. That is in the Supreme Court.
Yes. And if you have two or three benches on a particular roster, because the volume of a certain kind of litigation, this mentioning will then have to be done before the senior most judge who is dealing with that roster or something like that.
I think we can agree on this thing, that certainly in final hearings you have to have a stability on of a bench,
yes,
which is there for a semester. They can call out the first day all the matters which they are going to take up, so you can fix the final hearing and not leave it to the sweet will of the registrar.
That's right.
Who we don't know how they are doing it. Matters are coming up, not coming up. And then when the matters are listed, there is a procedure for timing and final hearing with written arguments beforehand.
That's
so
right.
You stipulate the time for oral hearing. It may not be 20 minutes because we're used to the art of advocacy. It may be 30 minutes or 1 hour depending on the case. So that can be instituted fairly quickly and certainly in constitutional matters.
But lawyers need to reform their ways of thinking as far as this is concerned.
But if you want to introduce this, we need to actually consult the judges, the lawyers, the litigants. And you were telling me earlier in the morning that, and I have experienced that, a lot of litigants come to the court and the matters are simply not taken up. And they spend so much time and money, and it's completely wasted because there's no time management.
Yes, I was giving you the instance of 3 professors who are waiting in court to present the point of view of their committee and then went back at the end of the day only because the case didn't reach. That's right. So at different levels, it could be ordinary workmen, people involved, housewives, people involved in matrimonial disputes. Anyone just cooling their heels in court.
But because in fact, they don't count in terms of time management.
That's
as
right.
Of today. It is only the court and the judge,
yes,
whose time is being considered as important. I think the judiciary has not thought about this. And for them, it's only their time. And if you want to try to evolve time management, you have to include the lawyer's time and most importantly, the clients and their friends who come with them for emotional support.
And there, it's not just the judges who need to be concerned with clients' convenience, but we lawyers also.
Yes.
Do we realize that when we take passovers and then the matters get adjourned, we are inconveniencing our clients?
But isn't it time that passovers are stopped completely?
But that goes hand in hand with time management.
Yes.
If lawyers know that their cases will be taken up at a particular point of time, then they have no business taking on other cases in other courts.
But
if they don't know, then a lawyer also wants to do some work on a given day.
Yes, yes, yes. So if you don't have passovers, then it's very clear. I think it's time to have no passovers. I think we've come to a particular conclusion, at least on time management, which can be instituted fairly quickly without much of a rancor. But there is a need to change both the lawyers and the judges' habits. So the clients' interest. We are going to discuss this issue further on case management, other things in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you.